Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Ranjit, one of the neonatal consultants from Rainbow Children's Hospital. I'm here to talk about, just go through the approach to the respiratory distress in a term newborn. So we're just going through a few cases and we will have a little approach to at the end and have a summary, some take home points. So the first case is a male infant who is was born at 38 week gestation. So who is 2 hours old now. Delivered by elective cesarean section for muhurtam delivery and presented with respiratory distress, has got some mild tachypnea, okay, with minimal retractions and saturations around 90% in room air and going up to 93-94 with the low flow oxygen. How do you approach this patient? So the first thing would be, okay, and the blood gas shows the pH of 7.25 with a CO2 of 44 and base of minus 4.8. The first step of investigation, as you would like to do, probably the chest X-ray. Just give you a few seconds to summarize the thing. So term baby with elective cesarean section with no other risk factors and with mild tachypnea. Yeah, as you're all thinking, it's quite straightforward TTMB for us. So the main the reason I want to discuss this case, can we avoid this type of situation? Could you have avoided this TTMB for this baby? So what did we say? So the lead points would be, please avoid pre-labor elective cesarean section before 39 weeks unless clinically indicated. But if needs to be done, clear recommendations to use antenatal steroids in elective section before 39 weeks gestation. So one of the most common presentations for the newborn with tachypnea, the transient tachypnea of newborn. Okay, we'll move on to the second case. It's a term baby who is 12 hours old now. Initially presented with respiratory distress, born by normal vaginal delivery, came to us at 12 hours of age and had meconium stained like a red bulb, no other risk factors for sepsis. So at the local hospital, baby was started initially having retractions and tachypnea, started on 2 liters low flow oxygen and saturations were not maintaining, so was referred to us. On arrival to us, baby was having severe retractions, tachypnea, nasal flaring, and grunting and saturations are 77% in oxygen in the low flow. The mean blood pressure sitting borderline. And we have done a blood gas which showed respiratory respiratory acidosis with hypoxia. So term baby with possible meconium aspiration. As you can, the X-ray shows the typical features of the meconium aspiration syndrome. So how do you deal with a case like this when you come into you? So this child, after coming to us, ended up in having high frequency ventilation, nitric oxide, and become very sick, and took almost 3 to 4 days to come out of the nitric oxide and slowly eventually out of the ventilator. So being in the first point of contact when we see the baby in the delivery room, how can we avoid this? So meconium aspiration, as you all know, main thing is it de-recruits the lungs. So early CPAP, and it helps to recruit the lungs. Please start CPAP very early on and avoid hypoxia and acidosis. And as you know, it can lead to PPHN, and early intervention and referral is crucial for better prognosis for these babies. Okay, move on to the third case. So term baby born by normal delivery and it was late booking, not much antenatal checkups, and baby noted to have mild respiratory distress but floating at the mouth and tried to have some feeding and had a vomit. On examination, baby had mild retractions, tachypnea, and have both oral and lots of secretions coming from the mouth and the nose. Saturations initially 89% in the room air and the blood pressure is 47. So, and the blood gas looks okay at this stage for this baby. And the initial chest X-ray, as you all can see, it's the nasogastric tube which is inserted is curling in the upper part of the esophagus. So diagnosis is straightforward with esophageal atresia with tracheoesophageal fistula. So then it's important for us to diagnose whether he's got a fistula or not. How do we diagnose that? We have a gastric bubble in the, as you can see in the chest X-ray. If there's a gastric bubble and air in the intestines, it's got a distal fistula. Otherwise, it's a blind esophageal atresia. If you have an esophageal fistula along with the atresia, it's important that we try and avoid the CPAP and intubation unless until baby really need to. Most of these babies settle with gentle suctioning of the secretions and taking away the obstructive part of the airway so that the baby starts breathing. Chest X-ray is the diagnostic for the tracheoesophageal fistula. Antenatal scans sometimes might have shown polyhydramnios for these babies. And suctioning the oral secretions with large bore suction catheter is crucial. So the replogal tube, which is not easily available in India, it provides both the airway and the suction for these babies. Okay, moving on to the next case. Case 4, it's a baby born at 37 weeks. It's a male infant. Antenatal scan shows anhydramnios from 30 weeks gestation and got bilateral hydroureteronephrosis. And baby was born by elective cesarean section in view of very low Likert and had antenatal steroids 2 days prior to the delivery. It's elective section. Baby started grunting from birth, needed high flow, very high oxygen requirement, and intubated. And on conventional ventilation, baby still needing very high oxygen requirement. So baby came to us at 4 hours of age, and the blood gas is showing severe respiratory and part two metabolic acidosis. And the chest X-ray done at this stage has shown this. Okay, so as you can see, the diagnosis would be he's got right side pneumothorax and she's got severe pulmonary hypoplasia. So typical baby with Porter sequence pulmonary hypoplasia, okay, causing right side pneumothorax. Okay, so the question is, how do we deal with this sort of cases when we attend the delivery? The main thing is delivery room management is key when we are anticipating pulmonary hypoplasia in these newborns. So early intubation with surfactant and following all the lung protective ventilation strategies. Sometimes we have tried using high frequency ventilation in the delivery room to protect these lungs, because these lungs are very fragile and they're prone to cause pneumothorax. And because they're very, very underdeveloped, they need very high pressure to open and oxygenate. And most of these babies end up having pulmonary hypertension. So delivery room interventions is very crucial. Most of these babies might also have pneumothorax in the delivery room. So please prepare for the chest drains in the delivery room itself. So delivery of these babies to be planned in a center where high frequency ventilation and tertiary NICU can be provided. So next, moving on to the next case, the male infant who is term gestation, who is 3 hours old when he was referred to us, have normal antenatal scans. Was referred with respiratory distress, okay, and there are no risk factors for sepsis for this baby. Initially started on low flow oxygen, saturations are around 85 to 88 in the local hospital. Typical an examination, you can see severe retractions, tachypnea, nasal flaring, grunting, and the clinching is the scaphoid abdomen, and saturations are around 93% in air. Blood gas is not too bad, so it's almost normal, pH 7.3 with a CO2 of 40. And the chest X-ray, give you a few minutes. So term baby with normal antenatal scans, but postnatally found to have this, which is some of you answered me saying that CDH. Yeah, postnatal diagnosis of CDH, which is very common to see, especially. And postnatal CGS has got a good prognosis. Most of them have minimal symptoms and might not need invasive respiratory support. So they will need surgical intervention, but you don't have to routinely intubate and ventilate these children unless until they are symptomatic. So clinical examination is clue. Next, going to the case, next case, it's a term baby who referred to us with stridor. And the typical stridor has retractions and what gets worse with the crying. Just with the history, any ideas? Anyone wants to mention? So we have done the upper airway assessment in view of the stridor for this baby. So yeah, as you can see, the larynx epiglottis is falling, and the laryngomalacia, typical laryngomalacia, is floppy larynx. And as you can see in the side, the baby is having severe retractions and things are getting worse as the baby is crying. So most of the time, laryngomalacia is self-resolving and in very severe cases might need supraglottoplasty. Okay, going to the next case, the term baby who is now 3 hours, so has got normal antenatal scans, referred to us with respiratory distress, and mother had ruptured membranes for 2 days and had frequent UTIs during the pregnancy. So baby presented with severe retractions, tachypnea, nasal flare, grunting, and saturations are 93% in air. The blood gas is showing mild acidosis. The chest X-ray, typical, as you, some of you are mentioning already, it's a straightforward congenital pneumonia. So the main thing is, when you're suspecting the congenital pneumonia, baby with a typical history of risk factors for sepsis and respiratory distress, early antibiotics is crucial, and early intervention to minimize the de-recruitment of the lungs might be needed to prevent the further deterioration. Next case is a term baby who was referred to us at 10 days, who initially had meconium aspiration syndrome, was intubated. The first intubation has been very difficult intubation. Eventually, baby had ventilation for 10 days and extubated, and failed extubation twice. And in both the situations, baby was failed because of the increased work of breathing and typically having retractions and the stridor. So the upper airway assessment with us. As you can see, the subglottic stenosis, it could be congenital subglottic stenosis. In this case, it's the iatrogenic secondary to the prolonged ventilation. How do you deal with it? So do the balloon dilatation is the first option for most of these acquired subglottic stenosis. So we have done the balloon dilatation for this baby. And post balloon dilatation, as you can see, the stenosis is improved. Postoperatively, I can see baby is very healthy without any respiratory distress, and had further up to 1 month postoperative at another assessment of the upper airway, the stenosis has disappeared. Okay, just moving on to the next case. So term baby with respiratory distress from birth. Okay, and born by normal vaginal delivery. No meconium stain like up, no risk factors for sepsis, typically has grunting and tachypnea and cyanosis on crying, which disappears on crying, sorry. So baby has got normal chest X-ray and normal blood gas. And as you can see, the main thing is the cyanosis improves with crying, which gives the diagnosis of choanal atresia. We were unable to pass the nasogastric tube in both the nostrils. CT scan is the diagnostic for the choanal atresia. So next, coming to the term baby who is now 6 hours old, initially referred with a respiratory distress, born by normal vaginal delivery, no risk factors for sepsis, intubated at birth for respiratory distress and high oxygen, saturations are 88% on ventilator. Okay, with FiO2 up to 80%, and the PIP very high pressure requirements for this baby. Blood gas showing both severe respiratory acidosis and also hypoxia. Differential diagnosis: chest X-ray showing. Give you a few seconds for you to think. So typical ground glass appearance. Okay, so possibly respiratory surfactant deficiency, lung disease. There is no history of meconium, no history of no risk factors for sepsis for this baby. Typical other things typically present like this would be cardiac conditions. With this baby had got obstructed TA-PVC. Main thing is hypoxia. So as some of you are answering here in the webinar, PPHN, it's very always important to differentiate between the PPHN and the cardiac causes. How do we differentiate? PPHN has got simultaneous both respiratory respiratory like grunting, retractions, respiratory acidosis, as like this baby. Cardiac specifically might be having a heart murmur, signs of failure. 2D echo is diagnostic for these babies. Important to differentiate, early 2D echo for these babies might help you to go into the right way of treatment. Almost look like RDS. So Next case, term baby with cleft palate and retrognathia. Retractions and grunting with desaturations needing CPAP. How do you want to deal with this? Yeah, as some of you mentioning, it's Pierre Robin. So this baby has got retrognathia, micrognathia, cleft palate, and without CPAP having retractions. Yeah, good. So as some of you are mentioning, main thing is crucial is prone nursing. Prone nursing resolves distress in most of these newborns. We might avoid this invasive or non-invasive respiratory support. Nasopharyngeal airway is an alternative which can be easily inserted, and we can easily teach the parents as well, and the parents and the baby can go home with the nasopharyngeal airway. The purpose of this nasopharyngeal airway is to remove the tongue from the airway. Okay, so and especially and the other problem these babies have would be the feeding. Heberman special needs feeding bottle helps for most of these babies. Some of these babies might end up going with the nasogastric tube feeding. So by clear educating the parents both with nasopharyngeal airway and the feeding techniques, we can avoid tracheostomy and gastrostomy for these babies. Coming to term baby who was born with normal vaginal delivery, is 3.5 kilos, infant diabetic mother, no meconium stain like her, no risk factors for sepsis, respiratory distress is there from the birth with severe retractions and grunting, saturations are 86% in room air, and with FiO2 on CPAP, 35% effort on CPAP is going up to 93%, and the blood gas showing borderline respiratory acidosis. Yeah, some of you already mentioning it, surfactant deficiency. So surfactant deficient lung disease most common in the infant of diabetic children. So we intubated this child and we given one dose of surfactant, and after 12 hours the X-ray still looks white out completely, and we put the transfer the baby onto high frequency ventilation, given second dose of surfactant, another X-ray, another after 12 to 24 hours still showing complete white out. How do you go about it? Most of you are mentioning RDS. Yes, agree. RDS is the thing. 2D echo is normal. Some of you mentioned TA PVC. 2D echo is normal for this baby. BPD, baby is only 2.5 days old. Someone got to the diagnosis saying, so ongoing high frequency repeat X-ray after 5 days still got complete white out of the lungs. No sepsis risk factors. Normal septic workup. Normal 2D echo. After 5 days of ventilation and 3 doses of surfactants, still got complete whiteout. Yeah, primary surfactant deficiency, or this baby then later to be surfactant protein B deficiency. Okay, so genetic analysis is important because it's a fatal condition, and it might have future implications. Last but not the least, a term baby presented with respiratory distress needed CPAP, and from day 3 becomes the respirations become more irregular and having intermittent apneas. So on CPAP, still baby having apneas, chest X-ray, blood gas, 2D echo are normal, electrolytes, calcium, magnesium are normal. Okay, and EEG, we suspected seizures because having apneas, we couldn't find anything wrong with the lungs or the heart. So we started investigating electrolytes, which are all normal neurologically. There's no seizure activity, EEG is normal. We have tried one dose of IV caffeine for this baby, still having apneas. Central hypoventilation syndrome, one of you mentioning, yes, good thought. But this baby more like having respiratory distress along with irregular breathing. Congenital myopathies, so we have started thinking about neuromusculars and congenital. So we have done for new imaging for this baby. Anyone want to diagnose? Yes, good. MRI, molar tooth sign, diagnostic of Joubert syndrome. Okay, here. So we have the confirmation by genetics. This child is 6 years old now, and have mild speech delay and and we have to give medications to decrease secretions, and he slowly came out of CPAP and discharged. Currently 6 years old, doing well with mild speech delay. Okay, when you have recurrent apnea, as you all mentioned in your answers, think about central apneas or obstructive apnea. Central apnea, when mainly looking into any neurological causes, neurological examination is crucial. Neuroimaging, neuro workup, any history of perinatal asphyxia, seizures is important. Okay, in obstructive apnea, most of these babies have noisy breathing, stridor, secretions. MLB might help you to clinch the diagnosis. The last case, term male infant who is 3.1 kilo, born, had normal pregnancy, normal antenatal scans, no risk factors for sepsis, born by elective cesarean section, respiratory distress and drooling of saliva noted at 2 hours of age. Baby was intubated and ventilated at the referral hospital and had 2 extubations failure and referred to us. So yeah, I would assume by this time we should have ruled off the TEF because had ventilation for 5 days, had x-rays which didn't show signs of TEF. So on examination, baby had lethargic tone, reflexes were very, very poor, pupils are normal. One important thing is this respiratory rate was very, very high. Sometimes it's going up to 120, 130. So over the next few days after coming to us, slowly we try to see if we can take out of ventilator onto CPAP. On CPAP over the next 40 hours, baby continued to have very severe tachypnea, almost going up to 120 to 130. So we went for the upper airway assessment, having mild laryngomalacia, otherwise rest of the tracheal bronchus is normal. Looking for the inborn antecedent of metabolism, IEM screen was normal. Looking for the neurological causes, MRI brain, nerve conduction studies, electromyography were all normal. Septic work was negative, 2D echo was normal. So we ruled out the cardiac causes, neurological causes, surgical causes for this baby. So during CPAP, especially this baby having biphasic respiratory pattern, sometimes goes up to 40, sometimes goes up to 150, 40 respiratory rate. So his respiratory is almost similar to the heart rate for this baby. So we went for the next level of investigations with impedance plethysmograph, revealed a respiratory rate, confirmed respiratory more than 150 per minute. Video recording of this baby showed very severe tachypnea, almost like a high frequency ventilation is going on. So we end up, we went to do the video fluoroscopic study. As you can see, the diaphragm, both diaphragms is going as fast as the heart. Anyone, any answers? Okay. So this baby was diagnosed to have respiratory flutter syndrome. So it's a diaphragm flutter. Okay, we started this baby on clofromazine and slowly the baby improved and went home, but have the recurrence of the symptoms. In the local hospital, had two admissions, eventually died at 6 months of age. Okay, so just to summarize, we've gone through so many cases. So whenever you're seeing a baby with respiratory distress, please go through whether baby having isolated tachypnea with increased work of breathing, is this associated with the hypoxia or any changes in the consciousness for this baby, mainly lethargy. So if all the 4 parameters are normal, we're dealing with a normal baby. If you have effortless tachypnea, most likely we are dealing with condition, TTNB, inborn antecedent of metabolism, or neurological conditions. Okay, if you have respiratory distress, more likely we are dealing with either respiratory pathology, upper airway pathology, or lower airway pathology, that includes lung parenchyma. Complete respiratory failure, severe respiratory distress, mainly severe parenchymal disorder or PPHL. All 4 will be abnormal. Okay. So examination and assessment is key. If you have upper airway, we have mainly retractions, upper airway suprasternal retractions. Tachypnea can be present. We have noisy breathing with stridor. If it's a parenchymal problem, mainly tachypnea with grunting, subcostal, intercostal retractions, and can have noisy breathings like wheeze and grunt. So just to summarize, a detailed history and thorough clinical examination gives us a clue in most of the clinical situations. Antenatal information can facilitate us to prepare the delivery room and also help us in clinching the diagnosis and providing the appropriate support. Assessment of severity using the various scoring systems, Downey score, Silverman-Anderson score, doing the blood gases will help you assess the severity of the condition, and appropriate early intervention prevents deterioration and need for invasive support. Main aim is to stabilize the baby with minimal support with appropriate escalation and diagnosis. Common things are common, although I have gone through some uncommon conditions, but they can present with common symptoms. So although most of the times as a neonatologist facing or pediatricians facing this newborn baby with respiratory distress, we are dealing with probably 8 to 10 common neonatal conditions. But if baby is not responding to our normal routine treatment as we anticipate, think about the uncommon conditions. Just in the current pandemic scenario, so anyone coming with COVID-19 pneumonia, currently there's no evidence for antivirals in the newborns. Please stick to the basics, routine supportive management with all the personal protection for both for the nursing staff and the medical staff and the supportive staff who helps in the hospitals. And azithromycin might help, okay? But I think we'll share the further information and evidence as we see more and more cases. Okay, thank you and stay safe.
Thank you, Dr. Ranjit. You have really opened up a Pandora box of respiratory cases in the newborn.
Thank you. So, hand over to Dr. Anupama. We'll have the discussion at the end if you want to ask any questions.
Good evening, everyone. I hope my slides are clearly visible. So we would be going through a few cases of dengue. There's nothing in disguise here. All the cases which we are going to discuss are dengue, but their manifestations are not the routine manifestations which we see in a day-to-day practice. Dengue is a global disease burden, and India is a high suitability or a sustainability place for dengue virus. It's endemic in 100 countries, and WHO has released that there were 390 million dengue infections occurring every year, and the highest infections were last year, and the vector is an Aedes aegypti mosquito, which is a daytime feeder. This was a study which was published in 2017, and if you can see, over the years, the incidence of dengue in the pediatric age group has been increasing. So it's an important mosquito-borne disease worldwide. There's no specific antiviral for this disease. There's no approved dengue vaccine. Most of us do recover, children do recover eventually in 5 to 7 days. 10% develop dengue, severe dengue in the form of intravascular leakage, organ impairment, and hemorrhage. And severe dengue presents with a lot of inflammatory or cytokine storm. WHO has classified dengue in the year of 2019 as dengue with warning signs, without warning signs, and severe dengue. So the warning signs being abdominal pain or tenderness, persistent vomiting, mucosal bleeds, lethargy, restlessness, hepatomegaly, and laboratory showing a rise in hematocrit with decrease in platelet count. And the criteria for severe dengue was severe plasma leakage causing dengue shock syndrome, a fluid accumulation, pleural effusion or tense abdomen, intra-abdominal hypertension causing respiratory distress, severe bleeding, and severe organ involvement in the form of liver and the brain. So what happens during dengue fever? Let us just have a brief snapshot of the pathogenesis. The dengue virus infects the mononuclear cells. It replicates in the Langerhans cells and the splenic macrophages. So the endothelial cells undergo apoptosis. There is endotheliopathy. Because of that, there is increased vascular permeability because of endothelial cell dysfunction. They replicate in the liver hepatocytes. They cause necrosis of the liver cells. This apoptosis, release of various toxic mediators, thereby causing consumption of platelets and increase in coagulation disturbances. They infest the tissue macrophages. They cause apoptosis of tissue macrophages. There's release of various inflammatory cytokines causing both endothelial dysfunction and disorders of coagulation. They cause bone marrow suppression and predisposing to disorder of coagulation. The body also develops antibodies against the dengue virus, and these antibodies react with platelets and plasmin, predisposing for endothelial dysfunction and disorders of coagulation, which predisposes to DIC. So let's look at the first case. We had a 5-year-old boy who presented with high-grade fever for 3 days, poor oral intake and vomiting for 1 day. He was admitted in the wards and started fluids at 3 ml per kg per hour. So he was taken as dengue, probable dengue with warning signs. His initial lab showed PCV of 38, platelet count of 1.1 lakh, WBC of 3000. His dengue antigen was NS1 antigen had come positive. And within 24 hours, he had to be shifted from the ward to the ICU in view of hypotensive shock. In the ICU, in the next 18 to 12 hours, he was resuscitated with volume and various hemodynamic parameters and lab parameters were used to titrate his fluids. And he was also started on IV immunoglobulin and steroids because of extreme hyperferritinemia. The first day, his first 24 hours lab showed extreme hyperferritinemia and elevated lactate, transaminitis, a deranged coagulation profile, with WBC count being around 4,000. Subsequently, in the day 2 and day 3, he had to be intubated in view of worsening shock, respiratory distress and encephalopathy. Lines were placed. He was ventilated on a PRVC mode. His pressures were around 22/7. His blood gas showed metabolic acidosis with lactate of 3. He had intra-abdominal hypertension. A bladder pressure monitoring was done, which was also very high. A 2D echo showed adequate by IVC volume. His hemodynamics stabilized by 24 to 48 hours and he was in a single inotrope, Adderall 0.15. In view of persistent intra-abdominal hypertension, diuretics were tried, but still they were high. A peritoneal drain was placed for him. On day 4, despite hemodynamic stabilization, taking care of his ventilation, addressing his intra-abdominal hypertension, giving immunomodulated drugs like steroids and immunoglobulin, assuming that there could be a HLH, the child continued to worsen with worsening metabolic acidosis, elevated lactate, worsening oxygenation status, and worsening in the inotropic requirement. There has been worsening in his lab parameters also, with an elevated procalcitonin and CRP, ferritin raised to 50,000, elevated liver enzymes, and deranged coagulation with jaundice. So what is going wrong with this child? This child presented in time to the hospital. There was no delay in coming to the hospital. He came with day 3 of symptoms. He progressed to shock within 24 hours. On day 4, he progressed to severe dengue with MOTS. Why is this child still deteriorating? So in these children with severe dengue and multi-organ dysfunction, despite adequate hemodynamic stabilization, addressing their abdominal, addressing abdominal compartment, giving them immunotherapy in the form of steroids and immunoglobulin, they still continue to worsen. So the various pathological problems can occur in these children. The reasons being either it is a secondary HLH or the child can have a familial HLH with a viral insult, the virus being the dengue virus. The secondary HLH can progress to a condition called macrophage activation syndrome, or the child can have a coexistent infection causing hyperferritinemic multi-organ dysfunction with sepsis. Before understanding the differences between these three pathological conditions and the therapeutic options for them, we need to understand a little bit of immunology behind this. When the dengue virus enters the body following a mosquito bite, there is a deranged immunity and there is a cytokine storm in some children. Initially, there will be local release of cytokines, and there will be these local cytokines will recruit more immune cells at the local tissue level, and the infected cells go to the lymph nodes, whereby the T lymphocytes and B lymphocytes are activated and they proliferate and release various levels of cytokines from interleukin alpha, beta, 6, 8 and all interleukin 10, TNF alpha, causing various problems like endothelial dysfunction, increased vascular permeability, injury to the liver, injury to the brain, and causing a pathology called cytokine storm. This is a study which was done by Kuzera et al. And they created a picture called dengue cytokine mandala, where all the cytokines in the body are elevated during dengue at various stages, like in simple dengue fever, dengue hemorrhagic fever, dengue shock syndrome, at different level periods. So it is theoretically, it looks okay, but practically it is not possible to measure all these cytokines for us. And in severe dengue, there is a battle between the dengue virus and the immune system because of antibody-dependent enhancement, cytokine storm, the host genetic factors, the virus serotype, the age, and previous immunity also predispose to this cytokine battle. Apart from this, we also have to understand something about NK cell for us to understand the differentiation between these three different pathologies which can be going on wrong with the child, either a familial HLH, a secondary HLH, or a sepsis-induced hyperferritinemic MOTS or sepsis causing secondary HLH. When there is familial HLH, it means it is genetic. In these children, their NK cells or cytotoxic T lymphocytes do not function properly. They are adequate in number, but they do not function. They do not have the cytolytic activity. So as a result, they cannot stop viral infection and lymphoproliferation. There is release of large amount of interferon gamma, thereby causing macrophage activation in ferritin. Whereas in case of rheumatological conditions or drug conditions which predispose to secondary HLH and that versus to macrophage activation syndrome, here the number of cells are reduced and the number of cells are normal, but their function is slightly reduced because of inflammation. And as the inflammation settles down, their function comes back to normal. In case of sepsis-induced macrophage activation syndrome, then NK cells and the cytotoxic T lymphocytes are decreased in number, but their function is fine. We need to understand this because this will help us to decide on what immunomodulation therapy these children would need. And in many of these viral infections, when there is hemolysis, there is free hemoglobin, and this free hemoglobin joins with the haptoglobin and it activates the macrophages and produces a large amount of ferritin. Excess production of ferritin by the macrophages or hyperferritinemia causes interleukin-induced liver injury, as well as suppressing the adaptive immunity and decreasing the host to clear the viral or the bacterial infection. So nowadays, ferritin has become a routine lab parameter for all of us. We are doing in dengue, we are doing in COVID, we are doing in most of the viral and bacterial infections. So what is this ferritin? Is it an innocent bystander of uncontrolled inflammation, or is it a mediator of immune dysregulation and which causes more release of pro-inflammatory cytokines and immune suppressive effects? Why is that? How does serum ferritin in dengue, and what are the clinical implications for us to understand the pathology or the pathophysiology behind ferritin? Ferritin in dengue is produced by monocytes, macrophages, and hepatic cells. Even when there is release of pro-inflammatory cytokines of free iron, it increases the ferritin production. In dengue, when there is secondary infection or microbial translocation, there's production of LPS or lipopolysaccharide that predisposes to ferritin production. Whenever there is bleeding or hemorrhage in dengue, this release of free hemoglobin, and the free hemoglobin haptoglobin complex stimulates the macrophages and thereby causes production of ferritin. So these are the various pathologies why there is hyperferritinemia. So clinically, whenever there's hyperferritinemia or extreme hyperferritinemia, where the ferritin value is more than 10,000, hyperferritinemia, we mean the ferritin value is more than 500, think that there could be a high viral load, there could be an associated secondary bacterial infection, look for liver injury or abdominal compartment syndrome, look for hemolysis, or the child could have a genetic predisposition for HLH. An extreme hyperferritinemia suppresses the B cell, causes T cell proliferation, decreases the immunoglobulin production, and predisposes to more infection. So how do you diagnostically differentiate between these various pathological conditions? Suspect familial HLH in any child with severe dengue if the age is less than 2 years, there is risk factors like consanguinity, previous sibling death, and CNS involvement, along with the 5 out of 8 standard criteria for HLH. Think of secondary HLH in older children, no previous predisposing factors, no consanguinity, no sibling death, and it's associated with any viral or bacterial infection. And these children also will have 5 out of 8 criteria. And secondary HLH progresses and worsens, it worsens to macrophage activation syndrome, and identify this in that spectrum of severe dengue children who have got non-remitting fevers, extreme hyperferritinemia where the ferritins are always more than 10,000. They have CNS dysfunction at presentation. They have severe liver involvement with DIC. They have hyponatremia, bicytopenia, and if you do a bone marrow, there'll be hemophagocytosis. And if you do inflammatory markers, there'll be have elevated soluble CD163. Macrophage activation syndrome is not a diagnosis of exclusion. It is a complication of a hyperinflammatory state predisposing to cytokine storm and fatality in these children with severe dengue. Think of dengue with hyperferritinemic MODs when there is secondary infection, and these children will have an elevated ferritin. They will have a hepatobiliary dysfunction with DIC. So we need to understand what pathology is going wrong with the child to choose a therapeutic modalities. If the child, if you're suspecting strongly a familial HLH with a coexistent dengue virus infection, start the child on steroids, dexamethasone and drugs like etoposide. If you're suspecting a secondary HLH, use steroids like methylprednisolone, IV immunoglobulin. If the child is more sicker, going towards macrophage activation syndrome, cytokine storm, think of doing CRRT, extracorporeal heme absorption therapy like CytoSorb, plasma exchange. Or if you're suspecting a child with dengue with hypoferritinemic multi-organ dysfunction, immunoglobulins and methylprednisolone, or drugs like anakirna, which is an IL-1 receptor blockade, or if there is associated renal failure, CRRT and plasma exchange. The bottom line is the same for all these children. Whatever the pathology be, they need supportive ICU care, they need organ supportive therapy. We have to treat and address their infections. So who would treat these disorders? Is it the intensivist, is the rheumatologist, is the hematologist? Because each one of them would choose their immunomodulators to which they are used to. A hematologist would prefer dexamethasone, etoposide, intensivist would prefer steroid, methylprednisolone, and rheumatologist would prefer more of biologicals or methylprednisolone at a very higher dose. So to decide which immunomodulator needs to be understood, again, we have to understand the underlying pathology of the underlying immunology or pathology, the problem the child is facing. If a child has got familial HLH, as we had discussed previously, they have normal NK cells, but these cells don't have the cytolytic activity. So they have a lot of interferon gamma production in them, which causes macrophage activation and hyperferritinemia. In these children, we need to use drugs like dexamethasone and etoposide. If you're not suspecting familial HLH in your child with severe dengue, you're suspecting either a secondary HLH, which is worsening and going towards macrophage activation syndrome, or a sepsis-induced hyperferritinemic MODs, or any child with a rheumatological associated macrophage activation syndrome, you would use drugs to decrease inflammation like methylprednisolone, IV immunoglobulin, consider plasma exchange, which will help in removing the ferritin, and drugs like anakirna, which is a recombinant IL-1 receptor antibody. Now, in these children, identifying the pathology is important because it will help in deciding what immunomodulatory therapy you would like to give to these children. In these children, especially with sepsis-induced macrophage activation syndrome, hyperferritinemic MODs, or rheumatological conditions causing these problems, we don't use drugs like etoposide and dexamethasone because these spectrum of pathologies, their NK cells in number are reduced or their number is adequate, but they have decreased function. So if you use drugs like etoposide or dexamethasone, they will not allow the NK cell and the cytotoxic T cell lymphocyte to resolve. In sepsis-induced multi-organ dysfunction, or if there is a rheumatological condition or a drug condition which is causing macrophage activation syndrome, in all these conditions, once the infection and the inflammation settles down, the NK cells will come back to their normal number, they will come back to their normal function. So when we use drugs like dexamethasone and etoposide in these children, we'll be iatrogenically preventing the recovery. So that is why understanding the underlying pathology and immunology to understand what pathological condition is happening for this child with severe dengue with MODs helps in deciding what immunomodulatory therapy these children need. In the baseline, all these children need ICU care, support their organ function, identify infections and treat the infections. In dengue is associated with a lot of liver injury. It could be from asymptomatic transaminase to fulminant hepatic failure, and the management is supportive care. Both hepatocytes and cells are primary targets for dengue viruses, and hepatocyte infection can lead to apoptosis and hypoxic mitochondrial dysfunction. So the above child had secondary HLH, which was progressing to macrophage activation syndrome. The child was started on CRRT. Infections were suspected, and after appropriate cultures, antibiotics were upgraded. Immunoglobulin, one more dose of immunoglobulin was given for the child. On day 6, the child had a severe upper GI bleed and worsening of shock. Child was resuscitated with blood products. Platelets were given in view of thrombocytopenia. So these were the labs on day 6, which showed that the hemoglobin is 6, the platelets are 35,000. Inflammatory markers like PCT, ferritin are coming down. The liver enzymes are getting better, but there is persistent DIC. So in this child, octreotide and IV prantoprazole infusion has been started. coagulopathy and thrombocytopenia was addressed with blood products. So what is the role of factor 7 in severe dengue with bleeding manifestations or life-threatening hemorrhagic conditions? So why does bleeding happen in dengue? There are multiple pathological reasons which we will not go in depth or detail. The dengue NS1 antigen inhibits as such the coagulation. The antibodies which are formed against dengue inhibit coagulation and enhance fibrinolysis. And there is increased vascular permeability and loss of a lot of coagulation proteins. So recombinant factor 7 can be used as an adjuvant therapy whenever there's life-threatening bleeding in severe dengue. The dose is 75 to 100 microgram per kg. It can be given as a single dose or repeated once in 4 to 6 hours. Rarely thromboembolic complications have been reported. So let's go to the next case. This is a 12-year-old boy. He came to our OPD with high-grade fever, vomitings, and loose stools. He was advised hospitalization because the doctor found that he had cool peripheries. He went to the ER, and in the ER he threw a seizure, and post the seizure his sensorium was not good. He had poor sensorium, GCS less than 8, and as he was in shock, he was intubated and a neuroimaging performed and labs have been sent. So now if you look at his labs, he has a high PCV hemoconcentration, his PCT is high, his ferritin is 16,000, slightly elevated liver enzymes, and subsequently dengue had come positive, and CT scan is showing bilateral thalamus showing bulky hypodense lesions as well as hypodense lesions in the brainstem, which is very pathognomic of a condition called acute necrotizing encephalomyelitis. So this child, immediately neuroprotective care was established. IV methylprednisolone was given at 30 mg per kg. He was started on IV tocilizumab, which is an interleukin receptor blockade. But despite this, this child had worsening neurological status over the next 10 hours, and he died at the end of 24 hours due to severe brainstem dysfunction. Every year, we see a cohort of these children who keep coming walking to the hospital, who end up getting diagnosed to have ANE, and within hours or days, we lose these children because of severe brainstem dysfunction. ANE is a clinico-radiological entity. It is an acute encephalopathy followed by viral illness, followed by seizures and loss of consciousness. This absence of CSF pleocytosis, this elevation of serum aminotransferase. What is pathognomic is bilateral involvement of the thalamus, upper brainstem, periventricular white matter, the internal capsule and the cerebellum. And there is no other disorder or disease explaining the above radiological findings. So most of the times they have a prodromal phase of cough, vomiting, diarrhea, and erythema, which can happen with any viral illness. And because of extreme hypercytokinemia in this disorder, cytokine storm, and elevation of pro-inflammatory cytokines, their blood vessels in the brain, there's alteration in the permeability, and they progress very rapidly to the encephalopathy stage with the seizures, loss of consciousness, and focal deficits. And from this stage, there is most half few of them have a rapid fatality. They die within the next 24 to 48 hours, despite therapies, despite giving neurointensive care, immunomodulators, plasmapheresis have been tried, and drugs like tocilizumab also has been tried. Those who recover, these recover with neurological sequelae. Some recover with full recovery. So there are various other neurological manifestations in dengue. Both dengue virus, dengue 2 and 3 are associated with neurological manifestations. The entry of the virus into the brain is through infected macrophages. 20 to 30% is the incidence of neurological manifestations. Sometimes we see most of the children encephalopathic, which is secondary to systemic causes like hepatic derangement, hyponatremia, capillary leak, and hypotension. So this was a paper which published all the neurological complications which are known to occur in pediatric dengue. You can also have post-infectious sequelae like neuromyelitis optica, ADEM, Guillain-Barré syndrome. They can present as encephalitis, myelitis, meningitis. And when you do a CSF, they have pleocytosis. They have increased protein. Sometimes you can get a hemorrhagic CSF. You can detect dengue viral antigens in the CSF also. So let's come. The reason for highlighting this case is because of the rapidity with how this disorder, the disease progresses. Well, let's come to the third case. This was a 14-year-old girl. She was intubated in the referral hospital in view of shock. She came with high-grade fever, vomitings, and decreased urine output. Because of shock, she was resuscitated with 2.5 liter saline and 500 ml of colloid. Then as her distress worsened and respiratory failure, they intubated there. She was transported to a hospital with two inotropes, adrenaline and noradrenaline. So when we did labs for her, Her PCV was 32. She had a very high WBC count, leukocytosis, platelets were 1.35, PC and lactate was 4.1. When an echo was performed and a bedside ultrasound was done, she had a congested IVC. And a dilated heart with poor cardiac contractility. Today echo was suggestive of myocarditis and ECG showed low voltage QRS complex. Her fluids were restricted, vasopressors tapered, and ionodilator was started. Diuretic infusion was commenced. Immunoglobulin was considered, but with respect to her age, because the role of immunoglobulin is questionable in myocarditis, it was not administered. Secondary infections were ruled out, and over the next 4 days, with serial improvement in her cardiac functions, she was extubated as her pulmonary edema got better. The reason for highlighting this case is not all children who come with dengue shock need not be because of increased vascular permeability. It is because of capillary leak syndrome. 25 to 30% is the incidence of myocarditis in overall severe dengue. So if you see a child with severe dengue who has leukocytosis and you find the child to be in shock and this you do a bedside echo and you see the IVC congested, multiple B lines in the lungs, assess the cardiac function and think about myocarditis in this child. So this child presented with a cardiogenic shock. She was resuscitated with a lot of fluids, assuming that she was in a dengue shock. And that predisposed to her to have pulmonary edema and made her land up on the ventilator. So incidence of dengue myocarditis is 15 to 27%, and 40% have functional abnormalities. The injury to the myocardium is immune mediated. Many of these children have leukocytosis and elevated biomarkers. They can present with acute heart failure and shock. And histological findings show that there's interstitial edema and necrosis of the myocardial fibers. Other common cardiological manifestation of dengue is in the defervescent stage where you see benign bradyarrhythmias and ectopic beats. So let's come to the last case. This is a boy who was admitted recently, 5-year-old boy, admitted in the month of June with history of 5 days, fast breathing for 1 day and decreased activity for 1 day. He presented in hypotensive shock. He was resuscitated with fluid and noradrenaline. Grandfather had a COVID pneumonia 1 month back and currently all his family members are asymptomatic. So you have done labs for him and his lab show a PCV of 29. Lymphopenia is there. Platelets are borderline 1.05 lakhs. His PCT is inflammatory markers, CRP and PCT are elevated. And his troponin I is elevated. He's got hypoalbuminemia. And when you send for etiological workup, dengue NS1 antigen is positive. COVID RT-PCR is negative and COVID antibodies are positive. You've done a chest X-ray, it shows a right side pleural effusion. 2D echo shows normal coronaries. And the shock stabilized on day 2. This child was given IV immunoglobulin and methylprednisolone and subsequently fever settled down over 48 hours. He had very high grade fevers. So what does this child have? Does this child have dengue shock? Or does this child have PIMS, which is temporarily associated with SARS-CoV, pediatric infectious multisystem syndrome? So what about dengue and COVID? So dengue and COVID is what we would probably see in the next few coming months. Both of them have different pathology, but the end is the same. They have endothelial dysfunction. In COVID, there is infection of the pneumocytes and the innate immune system gets stimulated and there is cytokine storm. In dengue, there is T cell immunology, antibody dependent enhancement and complement activation causing endothelial dysfunction. So this article is published in Springer in Switzerland and they have found out through various studies the difference in the clinical manifestations between COVID-19 and dengue, because both of them can present with the similar symptoms in the initial phase. If you look at this slide, cough, dyspnea and diarrhea are more towards a COVID-19, and the fever pattern is not specific like dengue where there is a saddleback or 2 weeks. But if you look at the lab parameters, both of them would be sharing more or less the same similar picture of thrombocytopenia, leukopenia, lymphopenia, transaminitis, and increased D-dimer. So this was a study which was published recently. The study was done in Calcutta in the Institute of Cellular Molecular Biology. So they found out that dengue antibodies can cross react with COVID antibodies and give false positive COVID antibody reports, and the vice versa can also happen. So currently in countries where dengue is endemic, and with this pandemic of COVID, serosurveillance should always be completed by doing a RT-PCR or a dengue antigen test to look for a definite diagnosis of dengue versus COVID in endemic countries. So most of us probably in the next few months would be seeing children either with a dengue shock having a false positive COVID antibody, or we would be seeing children with PIMS temporarily associated with COVID, and these children will have both COVID and dengue antibodies positives, but their PCRs can be negative. So how do we clinically differentiate them? In dengue shock, shock always follows after deficits of fever. Third day, fourth day, there's fever settles down, then the child goes into the capillary leak stage and there is shock. But in PIMS TS, during the febrile phase itself, the child will present with us in shock. Dengue shock is because of increased vascular permeability, capillary leak. It's a vasoconstricted shock. But in PIMS TS, mostly you'll see the shock being vasoplegic. Third spacing, like in pleural effusion ascites, will be more in dengue compared to PIMS TS. In dengue shock, you'll see a very high PCV because of capillary leak. In PIMS TS, because of capillary leak, you'll see more hypoalbuminemia. The liver involvement will be more or less same in both of them. You will see a deranged PT-APTT in dengue. In PIMS TS, maybe you will see a more of high D-dimer levels compared to dengue because of thromboinflammation. Thrombocytopenia might be significant more in dengue compared to PIMS TS. When you do a 2D echo, you might find myocarditis or functional abnormalities in dengue, but in PIMS TS, you might see involvement of coronaries or myocarditis. And this dengue shock, which progresses to severe dengue and hyperinflammation, hyperferritinemia, they will go into the pathology as we discussed in the first case, like HLH, secondary HLH macrophage activation syndrome. In PIMS TS, if there is hyperinflammation and it is not, and that can progress to refractory vasoplegia and toxic shock syndrome. So these are the four cases which I wanted to discuss because we commonly see these presentations in the ICU, and it needs a lot of diagnostic considerations and therapeutic management. Thank you.
Many thanks, Dr. Anupama. Excellent presentation and gone through the dengue cases. So open to discussion now.
Okay, please show case four slide once. Dengue with COVID, is that what they mean? So basically, this combination was thought because we have been seeing in the last 10 days children coming with PIMS, yes, that is multisystem inflammatory syndrome associated temporarily with SARS-CoV. Their RT-PCR is negative, but they're having COVID antibodies positive and dengue antibodies. They are not behaving like dengue shock syndrome. In dengue shock syndrome, we know shock is because of capillary leak, because of increased vascular permeability. These children don't have very high PCVs. They have fever during the shock phase, and the fever is settling down only if you address them with immunomodulators like immunoglobulin and steroids. They have more of hypoalbuminemia. Some of them are recovering this phase, going home and coming back with coronary involvement. This is what we have been seeing in the spectrum since the last 15-20 days. Probably Hyderabad is a little bit way back than Delhi and Bombay. Our colleagues in Delhi and Bombay are seeing now the more severe spectrum of PIMS or multisystem syndrome, where they're seeing toxic shock syndromes, refractory vasoplegias. Probably we might also see children having both co-infections. Dengue virus might be there, there could be coronavirus, but who would take the lead and who would cause more problems? I could not find any information about it.
I think someone wants to see the first slide, ma'am. First slide of the fourth case. Next question is, for every dengue case, do we need to send COVID test?
Yes, in this current situation, I think for the next few months, any febrile illness presenting with you with high grade fever, high inflammatory markers and shock, I think we should send dengue and COVID test. It should be a part of a fever panel, like how we send malaria, and if it's more than 5 days enteric, we should send both.
Someone's asking about what's the surgical intervention in Mayer Robin sequence. So if I have to answer that question, I would say mainly please try and avoid the surgical intervention as much as possible. So nasopharyngeal airway with good feeding techniques can get away without surgical intervention in the newborn period. stitching the tongue and the lower lip together sometimes helps some babies. And as the babies grow, most of them can have covered the retrognathic cover, but some babies might need mandibular advancement that will include space for them. I think that's all the questions I can see. So thank you everyone. We stop there. Peripheral setups, COVID serology, CAR test, can we do?
Antigen test, I think the government has not, in Telangana, I think the government has not allowed, but if you look at the ICMR guidelines, yes, rapid antigen test has been mentioned, but again, it is a zero surveillance. It is. Do you want to say clinically that this child has got a COVID infection? Even now, all the tests, the best is RT-PCR.
Someone's asking any early clinical sign for acute necrotizing encephalopathy.
I would say unfortunately no, because if you see the prodromal phase, these children have symptoms like any other viral or a bacterial infection, fever, vomiting, cough, cold. But they present, they are unusually sick. That is what we have noticed over the years. At presentation, they're unusually sick. And if you see in your outpatient someone presenting with this prodrome and the clinical look makes you feel that they're unusually sick, better is to get them investigated and hospitalized. The child which I had presented had come walking to our OPD, and it was only 24 hours that he had progressed so badly that despite providing him immunomodulation and all other therapies, he succumbed. But it is difficult. Every child, you will not be doing CT scan for ANA. So, but if you see someone with this prodrome and you find them to be the look-wise unusually sick, at least get them the investigation. Then these children, most of them have transaminitis, elevated ferritins, high PCs, high inflammatory markers. Prednisolone, please highlight. Dose of IVIG, all the we are being given 1 gram per kg. HLH, if you look at HLH 2004 to criteria, is 0.5 gram per kg. But if you look at the recent articles by Dr. Carcillo, who is an expert with respect to secondary HLH and hyperferritinemic multi-organ dysfunction, he mentions the dose is 2 gram per kg given over a period of 1 to 4 days. Methylprednisolone, the dose we use is 1 to 2 mg per kg. Unless it is some rheumatological condition which has predisposed the person to secondary HLH or macrophage activation syndrome, it is 30 mg per kg.
Is there any role? Doxycycline in dengue?
Doxycycline, yes, few studies have been done in dengue that doxycycline, when used empirically in dengue, decreases vascular permeability. So I would say it is up to the individual clinical practitioner, because now doxycycline, azithromycin, we are using for COVID also. So there is no full evidence, but yes, studies have found that by using doxycycline, the capillary leak can come down, the inflammation comes down, cytokine levels come down.
Someone's asking, what about sickle cell and thalassemia children? How to interpret serum ferritin in dengue HLH?
How to interpret serum ferritin in? I didn't get the question.
In sickle cell and thalassemia children, how to interpret serum ferritin in dengue HLH?
Yes, so that's a very nice question, because sometimes we did see last year sickle cell anemia, thalassemia coming with dengue, secondary dengue. So in these children, serum ferritin will be high, either because of anemia or because of iron overload. But if you just see an isolated ferritin elevated, other parameters are okay. The child's bicytopenia is getting better, organ dysfunction is not worsening, then it is unlikely that this child is going to develop secondary HLH. You can look at the other parameters, like if you could do a fibrinogen level, hypertriglyceridemia, but I would look at the spectrum of 48 hours. If I see an elevated ferritin with a child with sickle cell anemia presenting to me with dengue shock, even after fluid resuscitation, the ferritin level is high, but other parameters like organ dysfunction has not worsened, DIC has not worsened in this child, and the child is clinically getting better, then I will ignore this high ferritin. This high ferritin could be secondary to anemia or iron overload in case of thalassemia. Do we need to do troponin? With respect to COVID, And PIMS TS, yes, it has been in all these recent guidelines, they are mentioning us to do troponin and pro-BNP. Now, with respect to dengue, if you suspect dengue myocarditis, yes, you can go ahead and do a troponin. Every dengue shock, you do not need to do troponin. You can identify dengue myocarditis by a bedside echo and or a bedside ultrasound by looking at the IVC. If you see a congested IVC with a poor cardiac function, do an ECG. ECG shows low voltage QRS complex. Then you can suspect dengue myocarditis and send troponin.
So you're using antivirals in the COVID currently?
Yes, we are using remdesivir. If there is severe COVID where the child is ventilated, oxygen requirement is worsening, we are using remdesivir in severe COVID. Other antivirals, no, we are not using in pediatric. Abiflufapinavir, no, sir. So far, we have not used in our COVID positive children. HCQ. Initially, when HCQ had the glory, we did use for the first 3-4 cases. After that, no, we are not using HCQ in pediatric COVID. Even the NIH guidelines mentioned remdesivir in severe cases, and we have used in some children. I think in newborn COVID, azithromycin is recommended, sir.
Not recommended. There is no specific recommendation, especially there is no evidence for the antiviral as such. But as it, you know, the safety profile, probably you can try, but still there's no clear recommendations as for it.
Probably you would see a combination of dengue and COVID antibodies also positive in newborn.
So currently we have one child, newborn 16-day-old, presented initially with the dengue positive, and then the COVID also come positive to us. But it's a cross reaction of the antigen test that we are doing it, or they're both positive.
But COVID PCR,
low flow oxygen only.
COVID PCR is positive or negative?
Positive.
Okay, so it's most like a co-infection.
NS1 positive and PCR positive.
Now we are doing serology tests for COVID antibodies at the moment. We are not doing any CAR test.
Yeah. Okay, shall we stop there now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you very much for your presentation and good interaction from the audience. And thank you. Have a good evening all, and stay safe.
Thank you. Thank you.